We need templates. That's for sure. My team and all my clients use templates. I want to be clear about that. But how we use them is what makes the difference between success and failure. So customers know what a spammy, non-personalized email looks like, right? Think about it in your life. You know what it feels like almost before it hits your inbox, right? So they are so easy to spot and delete these things. So your email will get deleted if it's not personalized using research. And the final way that you may be sabotaging yourself here is really by not being brief and blunt and basic. So the best way to show you what I mean is, you know, to actually show you. So let me give you an example of from a real life client that I'm working with. So a quick example from Danielle. Danielle sells a software tool, and her target market is executives in charge of customer service and self-service type experiences using call centers, or what is now being called a contact center. So Danielle's market are companies that have a group of people that sit in a room that need to interact with customers. It could be customer support, could be inbound sales, could be outbound sales, could be technical support, whatever it is, right? So let's just have a look here at her email. And she's saying, John, noticing that you added chat to your contact center 3 months ago. Boom. It is all about, you know, hitting them over the head with the fact that you've done some research. And it's not, oh, by the way, I saw you on LinkedIn and I saw that you're the decision maker for call centers, you know, and I'm someone who's, you know, going to get into this whole thing with you now. You know, hey, I noticed that you added chat to your contact center 3 months ago. This does not sound like a piece of spam, right? This sounds like a note from someone, a human being, right? This triggers me to ask you, how would you know when it's time to consider adding screen sharing? Whoa, that's a really smart question. If you're John, you're thinking, all right, well, why is Danielle asking me a question about how I make decisions? It's a lot different than saying, hey, are you aware of this solution, or would you like to have a meeting with me? Right? It's just totally different in the context of this is, you know, Danielle has done research. So there's other parts here that I can get into, but we have such limited time together. I just want to kind of move past and just remind you that this is hands down the most powerful thing that you can be doing with your cold email. Is researching the prospect and then hitting them over the head with your research to, again, prove that you're not a bloody spammer. So, okay, Liam, the other way I see people making their lives miserable is by asking for meetings in their cold email. You should avoid this. In 95% of the clients that you're calling on, 95% of the time, they're not in buy mode, right? They don't yet realize that they need to speak with you. So because they haven't surfaced the pain yet, the problem or they have yet to set a goal for themselves. The need for your thing has not materialized yet. And if you ask for the meeting too soon, they're just going to say no, of course, right? So, or they're going to delete you only to set a meeting with a competitor of yours 2 months later, all because you ask for a meeting too soon. Instead, it's best to provoke, don't ask for, a discussion that leads to a potential meeting. And why would you want to provoke a discussion that would lead to a meeting? Because I got to tell you, and you know this is true, guys and gals, mobile, right? People don't have the time to be reading, you know, more than after 5 to 7 seconds. I mean, the data is in. You have 8 seconds, actually, before someone is going to decide to delete you in the business-to-business context.